Hello friends, welcome back to the TETRAHEDRON chemistry classes. So guys, in today's class I am going to take these SN2 reactions, that is a nucleophilic substitution of second order. So very quickly we will see the features, what are the features of these nucleophilic substitution reaction of second order. First of all, you should remember this particular point: the reaction is bimolecular and it is a second order reaction. So what is the meaning of that? That means the rate of the reaction would be directly proportional to your substrate, right, as well as your nucleophile, right? Both will affect the reaction rate. That means the reaction is of second order. So I have written K2 because it is denoting the second order rate constant. So, and see, bimolecular, that means two molecules are involved in the rate determining step. So what is the meaning of that? Say if you double the concentration of the substrate, right, and also double the concentration of the nucleophile, then the rate of the reaction would become 4 times. Similarly, if you say tripling the concentration of this one and doubling the concentration of the nucleophile, then your rate would be 6 times, and so on. In this way you can see, right? And second step, it is a single step reaction. Single step reaction means whatever the new bond would form in the product and whatever the old bond would break in the reactant, this would occur in only single step, and such type of reactions are known as the concerted type of the reaction. So concerted reactions are those reactions in which the bond breaking as well as the bond formation occurs simultaneously. Okay, then you can see the next point. There is no carbocation intermediate. Say if you recall the SN1 reactions, so in SN1 reactions your carbocations were forming actually, but here in this case there would be no formation of any reaction intermediate. However, a high energy transition state would be there in case of your SN2 reactions. Okay, so since no carbocations are forming in the SN2 reaction, that means no rearrangement of these carbocations would occur. So in SN2 reaction you will not find the rearrangement type of things, because no carbocations are formed in the reactions, right? And see, polar aprotic solvents, you will need polar aprotic solvents in this case. So I have made already a video on these solvents and the elimination and the substitution reactions, where I have explained these solvent roles in the detail. So for timing, you can notice polar aprotic solvent means, that mean you can have your, say, acetone, then you can have your DMSO, you know, this is dimethyl sulfoxide. What you can do, you can replace the carbon with sulfur, then you can have your DMF, dimethyl formamide, and then you are having your crown ethers. Okay, so crown ethers are also very important solvent in case of the SN2 reactions, fine. And see, there is a special type of thing which would be occur here in this in these SN2 reactions, that is a Walden inversion. See, a Walden inversion is what, you know, it is actually the after the name of the scientist who discovered this phenomenon for the first time, that is Professor Paul Walden, if I am not mistaken the name, his name, it is Professor, he was Professor Paul Walden, right, who gave the inversion concept. What is the meaning of the inversion? That means if you have started your reaction with the optically active compound, say your compound is having, say, certain kind of configuration, like it is a compound is having R, so your product may get your inverted, that means your product will have the inverted stereochemistry, that means R would become S. If your reactant is S, then your product would R. So this is actually the inversion of configuration, but this inversion of configuration may not necessarily will always take place in the SN2 reaction, right? I will explain this with the help of the example, but you should remember one thing. See, Walden inversion would always occur. Whenever you do SN2 reaction, always your Walden inversion would occur, but inversion of configuration may or may not occur, right? So this I will explain when I will go to the mechanism for that one. So when you are getting the inverted product, so no racemization. See, recall in case of your SN1 reaction, you were getting your 50% of one type of isomer and 50% of other type of isomer, right? So in that case, racemization was happening actually. In this case, there would be no racemization. You will get the single product. And you know these concerted reactions generally give the product with particular stereochemistry, and they are the stereospecific reactions. Concerted reactions are generally stereospecific reactions. So you can see SN2 reaction is also stereospecific reactions. See, now I am assuming that you must be aware about the stereospecific reactions. So stereospecific reaction, though, see, I have already made a video on the stereospecificity and stereoselectivity of these of the reactions. So if you haven't seen that video, so here is the playlist in which I have explained all the type of the stereospecificity and stereoselectivity. But for time being, you can note that these SN2 reactions are here. Stereospecific reactions, that mean if you do your reaction with the starting material, that means substrate having a particular stereochemistry, then your product would also have the particular type of the stereochemistry, right? If you change the stereochemistry of the substrate, then definitely the stereochemistry of the product would also be changed. This is the meaning of the stereospecific reaction. Okay, and next point you can see, the primary substrates are pretty much reactive in this case. See, if you have the, see, if you are going for alkyl halides type of thing, that mean your primary alkyl halide would be fastest reacting in the SN2 reaction, right? While your tertiary substrate would be least reactive in the SN2 reaction. I will explain with the help of the example. So these are the important feature which you should remember whenever you are going to draw the mechanism for your SN2 or SN1 kind of the reactions, right? So see, these, why I am telling the, why I am telling these features actually. So see, in your JEE examination, you may have the question based on these concepts also. Okay, so now very quickly I'll show you the mechanism, how the mechanism goes for this SN2 reaction. So mechanism, right? So I'm writing here the mechanism of the reaction. Mechanism, okay. So as I have written here, your primary substrate are most reactive towards this reaction. So what I am doing, I am taking the special case of your primary substrate. That mean I am taking, say, this is carbon, and say this is your a bromine. Okay, so I am taking this example. However, I can put the X also instead of this Br. So and then you can have your, say, these three hydrogen. So what the molecule is actually? Molecule is your methyl bromide. It's a special case of the primary substrate, and you know this bromine is actually the leaving group in this case. Okay. And if you do the reaction with any your nucleophile, right? And say, I am writing it as, say, you are taking this OH negative as nucleophile. So this negatively charged species is the nucleophile. And you are taking, say, solvent. Say you are doing this reaction in the DMSO. Right, so guys, it's quite sufficient if you know the reagent used, solvent used in the SN1 and SN2 reaction, then you can very quickly tell what kind of mechanism is given in the particular kind of reaction. So whenever you find the polar aprotic type of solvents which are not having the polar hydrogen, right? So this generally leads to the SN2 kind of the mechanism. So how the reaction mechanism goes? So you can see, when it, see this OH is negatively charged, and of course two lone pairs would also be there on the oxygen atom, right? So what happens if this nucleophile, right, try to approach this center? You know, this carbon is actually positively charged, and this halogen is negatively charged. So this is positively charged, right? So that means it is it will love the nucleophile. So it is an electrophilic center. So this center, you can call it what? Electrophilic carbon, you can call it as electrophilic carbon, right? And this species is nucleophile. So the moment this nucleophile try to approach towards this electrophilic carbon through this way, then of course this bromine would also have the three lone pair on it. So what happens? The electronic repulsion would occur. So when due to this electronic repulsion, this nucleophile cannot approach to this electrophilic carbon through this path, right? So as I already told you, these molecules are very, very clever. They do only those things which are easier for themselves, right? So now this OH is finding quite difficult to approach from this direction. So what this nucleophile do actually, it will attack the nucleophile from the back. Okay, it will attack the nucleophile from the back. So when it is attacking from the back, so it will give you your say a transition state. So what kind of transition state one can accept in this, in that case, say this is your carbon and the three hydrogens attached to this one, fine. And you see this nucleophile is approaching from the back, so it is conventionally this is shown by this dashed line actually. That means partial bond is there. That means bond is now starting to form with this electrophilic center. Similarly, you can find you can put the bromine just like that with the partial bond representing that the bond is starting to break. So here bond is the nucleophile is forming, starts forming bond with this carbon simultaneously, right? It will start this bromine will start breaking bond with that carbon atom. So this actually happening in the simultaneously, but remember it is simultaneous, but not necessarily they are not actually synchronously. Simultaneously is there, but not they are synchronous. Okay. And you see what you can do, you can put say partial negative on it, and you can put partial negative on it. So both are having the negative sign. That mean they are actually starting forming this nucleophile is starting forming bond here, and it is actually the bond breaking is starting from here. And see what you can do, you can put this pentavalent species. So what you are finding here, see, carbon is having 5 valency, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So this is actually the pentavalent. It is pentavalent. Okay. And this is actually the TS, transition state. Transition state, you know, it is the high energy state, because carbon, the general, see, normal tetrahedron valency concept, you are already knowing about this carbon, but it is pentavalent now. So it is actually the high energy transition state. So I am writing it as high energy transition state. Okay, so this transition state is there, but there is no formation of carbocation. You can notice no carbocation is actually forming here. And finally, what happens, this your pentavalent state will give you the product in this manner. Okay, here I am writing say OH, and rest of the three hydrogens are there, plus your leaving group, that is a Br negative. So this is the general mechanism actually, but there it is not enough to know this kind of mechanism. You should know some very important concepts also. So first point is that you can see here my nucleophile is approaching from the back, but it is not enough to say that this nucleophile is approaching from the back side, but it must approach through the axis actually. See, this if I can draw this like this actually, so however the size of the loops would be different in that case. Actually, this is the bonding orbital. Okay, this is bonding orbital, and in this axis there would be antibonding orbital, and this antibonding orbital is actually the vacant one. So in this vacant antibonding orbital, the nucleophile will donate its electron, and then the bond formation would occur. So it is not like that this nucleophile is approaching from the backside. The stereochemical demand of the reaction is that it must approach through the carbon halogen bond axis, because along this bond axis there would be the antibonding molecular orbital of this CBr bond, in which the donation of the electron pair from the nucleophile would occur. This you must know actually, right? So it will attack from the back as well as through the axis, so that it can donate the electron pair to the vacant antibonding orbital. Fine, this is the first very important point. And the second important point is that you can see here your reactant. So your reactant is that mean Br is having here, right? So if I can redraw this molecule here, say this is CBr and rest your hydrogens, okay? And now I am drawing the product here, okay? Hydrogen, 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 and my OH is here. You can see the clear difference between the product and the substrate actually. So what is the difference here? You can see this CBr bond is on the right hand side in the substrate, but here you see the new bond which is formed between the carbon and the nucleophile, it is on the left hand side. And these three hydrogen which are actually on the left hand side in the substrate, they are actually on the right hand side of the substrate. This is known as the Walden inversion. This is known as Walden inversion. Walden inversion. Fine. And it is actually, the inversion is after the name of Professor Paul Walden. Okay. Right, you can think in this way, that you have an umbrella in the stormy season, and suddenly in the wind and the storm, your umbrella is going inside out. That means spokes would go outward, and see what is happening here. Say these are the spokes of your umbrella, okay? And say this is the handle of your umbrella, okay? This is the handle of the umbrella, and in the product you can see spokes actually are on the right hand side and your handle actually are on the left hand side, okay? So this is known as the Walden inversion. It is not the inversion of configuration actually, but it is the inversion of the geometry actually. That's why I have written a point here. If you can notice here, Walden inversion would always occur, but inversion of configuration may occur or may not occur. So this is the example. Walden inversion is happening, which is nothing but it is the inversion of the geometry of the molecules. That means substrate going to the product is actually changing its configuration. That mean right. And then you can see in this way, if I would have started my reaction with chiral substrate, okay, say then you can say okay, there would be the inversion of the configuration. Fine. So these are the features. Say for example, you can see if I can replace this, say I can write like this. This is carbon, say this is Br, say this is hydrogen I am giving it, and say okay, this is dashed line, and here I am writing CH3, okay, and here say I am writing C2H5. So this center is what you can see, it is the chiral center actually. Why? Because all the four valencies are different. If you want to give the name to this compound, so you can very easily see it is actually S. It is having the configuration of the S. So I have already made a video on the RS configuration of these kinds of the molecules. If you haven't seen that video on the RS configuration, then you can go through the link, right? Here is the link, and see how we can decide the configuration of the molecule, right? For time being, you can notice in this manner. So this is the priority number 1, this is the priority number 2, this is the priority number 3, this is the priority number 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. So you are actually moving clockwise, right? So it is not actually S, it is having R configuration, okay? So this compound, if undergoes SN2 kind of the reaction, then the product you would have actually, okay, so I am writing in this way. Say this is your OH, if you have used this nucleophile, and rest your say your C2H5 and your CH3, then it must have S configuration. So right now I am not knowing it is actually S or R, so you can give the name. Say this is 1, this is 2, this is 3 if it is below the plane. Okay, so you are moving in the, in which direction you are moving? 1, 2, 3, you are moving in the counterclockwise. So S, okay, fine, it is fine. So in this case, you can see if you have started your reaction with the chiral substrate with definite configuration and you are going for this SN2 reaction, then definitely you are having the inversion of configuration. This is known as inversion of configuration. Fine, this is known as the inversion of configuration, right? And also the Walden inversion, both is happening here actually, but in that case only Walden inversions is happening, but no inversion of configuration because your starting material was not the chiral type of thing. So this is the general mechanism of the SN2 reaction, and again I am telling you, this SN2 reaction is not only related to the alkyl halides. Whenever you are finding this electrophilic carbon and your nucleophile, then you may have your SN1 or SN2 kind of the reaction depending upon the nature of the substrate, whether it is primary, secondary or tertiary, right? And you can see it is having, say, a nucleophile, right? So you can decide in this way. Now another very important aspect which I must tell you, which is this one, I have written here, primary substrates are pretty much reactive for the SN2 reaction, while tertiary substrates are not that much reactive. So now I am comparing the tertiary substrate. So what I am doing, say, now I am taking my tertiary substrate, say this is carbon, and I am writing, say this is CH3, and say this is CH2CH3, and similarly I'm writing here CH2 CH2 and CH3, okay, and here I am giving a leaving group. Of course, if you see this one, so this would be again the using same concept, this would be positively charged carbon, this is negative, it's an electrophilic center, okay. And now say if you are having your nucleophile, of course negatively charged or neutral, whatever, it will not approach from this direction due to the repulsion created by or given by the halogen which is attached to the substrate. So it will attack from the backside. Now the moment if you change your substrate from, say, primary, say this one was your primary, right, to the tertiary one, you see this methyl group is quite bulky. It is having the bigger size actually when compared to the hydrogen, and this ethyl CH2CH3, it is actually CH2, right? So this is CH2CH3 and this is CH2CH2CH3, this is propyl group, okay. Now this nucleophile must attack from the backside. Now you can see there is clear steric hindrance created by the three bulky groups which are in the form of, so it is very, very difficult for this nucleophile to approach to this electrophilic carbon from the back side also. This is known as the steric hindrance. Due to this region, your tertiary substrate, right, your tertiary substrate actually never gives SN2 reaction. They never gives SN2 reaction. And on the same ground, I told you in the in SN1 classes, your primary substrates never give actually the SN1 kind of the reaction, right? This I have explained already. So that's why I have written here in the see features, primary substrates are more reactive. Why more reactive? Because the size of the hydrogen is quite small, so the nucleophile can easily attack from the backside or from the rear side actually. But in case of the tertiary, you will never find that this nucleophile would approach from here. That's why the reaction will never happen actually. If you use the secondary substrate, then of course you should control your reaction by making, by changing the polarity of the solvent, the nature of the solvent, right? All these things. So you can derive this SN2 reaction also towards your desired one, whether SN1, see, it can give SN1 or it can give SN2. So if you change the solvent, right, if you put that secondary alkyl halide, right, this one, If you put the secondary alkyl halide in the aprotic solvent, then you are driving your reaction towards SN2 reaction, right? If you put this secondary alkyl halide in the polar protic solvent like your alcohol, then of course you will derive your reaction towards SN1 reaction. This I have already explained to you. So these alkyl halide substrates are actually quite typical. They do SN1, they do SN2, they do elimination reaction, they do E1, they do E2, right? All kinds of reaction they can give. And again, I have made a video on these elimination and the substitution reaction of alkyl halide. If you haven't seen that video, again, here is the link. You can go through the link and see how we can decide in which conditions your elimination would occur and in which condition your substitution would occur. Okay, so this is the general mechanism of the reaction. Okay, now one very important thing which I must tell you is the energy profile diagram. Okay, so I am writing it here, energy profile diagram. So how you can draw the energy profile diagram? Quickly you can see, say this is my reaction course, that means along the x-axis my reaction is happening, and in that case the energy is there, and then you will have this kind of thing, right? Only one you see delta you are finding here. So what is the meaning of that? Here your reactants are there, okay, and in that case you are having your products, and here you will have your transition state, high energy transition state. And if you take the difference of this one, then this will give you the activation energy. Okay, so this high energy transition state is actually this particular one, the pentavalent high energy transition state. Only one transition state is there, no formation of carbocations type of thing, which you have seen in case of your SN1 reaction, where you are finding the two transition states and one carbonium ion, right? And three transition states and one carbon ion when you are using your neutral nucleophile. So this I have already explained in my SN1 reaction. So this is the general mechanism of SN2 reaction and SN1 reactions. Now it is not enough to know the mechanism of the reaction only, but you should also know how actually how you can identify the different kinds of the products which are forming in the SN2 reaction. So now we'll see lots of problem based on these SN2 reactions, somewhere around 14-15 problems. And in these problems, after solving those problems, you would be quite confident that you would be quite confident to solve the various problems asked in the CSIR, so asked in the your IIT JAM, of course in your CSIR NET also, and the NEET examination also, right? So now I am going to the different kinds of the problems based on this one. Okay, so here you can see these are the problems. Okay, so now for time being you forget about your SN2 reaction and say you have given this kind of reaction, and the question is like that, which mechanism this reactant would undergo when using this alkyl halide. So what you will see the solvent. So this solvent is what? If you check this solvent is acetone, nothing else. This is what? Acetone. This is CH3 here. This is CH3 here. This is polar aprotic solvent. And you know, whenever you use the polar aprotic solvent, the mechanism is of the SN2 type. That means the SN2 reaction mechanism would occur here. How? You know, the sodium is positively charged and is negatively charged, right? So see what happens actually, polar aprotic solvents like your DMSO and your say DMF, your crown ethers, what they do actually, they stabilizes this actually the positively charged species, which is present as the counter ion, in your nucleophilic substrate, okay, nucleophilic reagent, attacking reagent, right? So this I negative actually set free an these sodium ion actually got engaged with these nonpolar polar aprotic solvent. Now this negatively charged I negative ion would attack on this one. So there is no question of attack here because the methyl is here and hydrogen is here, and we are considering the reaction of the alkyl halide. So this is your alkyl halide. Fine. Now what you can do, you can give a name to this one, whether it is R or S. So how you can decide the configuration? Say this is 1, this is priority number 2, this is priority number 3, and this is the priority number 4, and you are moving the counterclockwise direction, that means the anti-clockwise direction. So it seems actually it is S, but your lowest priority group is on the horizontal line, so it is actually R. Okay, so very quickly I am assigning this RS configuration, and assuming that you must be aware about these all these things. If you are not aware about these things, then you can go through the lectures on this tetrahedron chemistry classes, where you will find how to decide these configurations. Okay, so what would happen? This has to approach from the back of this bromide, this bromine actually. So because this cannot attack from this direction, because 3 lone pairs would be there on the bromine atom, so this will not attack here. So this negatively charged iodide would attack from this position. Okay, so attack on this electrophilic carbon, attack from attack occurs from the back of the halide ion, which is actually this direction, and you will have your product. So what product you will have here, it's quite easy. You can put your methyl here, and you can put your ethyl here, and in the methyl here and hydrogen here. Okay, the moment this iodine would approach from this direction, it will push this hydrogen towards the left hand side. So you will have your hydrogen here, okay, in that direction, and your nucleophile, which is I negative, and this will get this I would come here actually, right? And again, if you decide the configuration for this one, so how you can go for this one? Say this is 1, priority number 1, this is priority 2, this is priority 3, this is 4. So you are going clockwise direction. It is it seems that it is R, but the lowest priority group is on the horizontal line, so it is actually the S configuration. So this configuration is S. So you have started your reaction with the chiral substrate, and you will and you end up with your product with S configuration. So this is what your inversion of configuration. So here inversion of configuration is happening. So this is just the one example. Okay, now you can think in another way. Say for example, if you have this substrate, so very quickly what I can do, I can assign the configuration of this one. So I am telling you, this substrate is actually your 1, 2, 3, it is S actually. Okay, and now this iodine, this iodide, that means the nucleophile, has to attack on this electrophilic carbon. Here it is the electrophilic carbon. So the attack would occur from the back of your halogen. It cannot attack from this direction. Okay, this direction the attack cannot occur, because the lone pair present on the bromine would repel this nucleophile. So it will attack actually from the backside. When it is attacked from the backside, it will push this carbon hydrogen bond on the right hand side. So you will have your ME here, and this carbon hydrogen bond is actually pushed on the right hand side. This is ET, and this I negative you will find here. So this would be your product. Okay, and this product, if you it has formed the bond, so there is no question of the negative charge on it. Now if you see the configuration of this one, this is actually your R configuration. So again, inversion of configuration is happening, and the key is that you are using, what kind of substrate you are using here? You are using solvent, you are using polar aprotic solvent, that means you are acetone you are using here. So in both the cases you are using the acetone, and you are using the same nucleophile, and you are ending with the same kind of your inverted configuration of the product. So these are the two problems which I have explained on the basis of the Fischer projection diagram. Now moving to the next one. Okay, say this one, this two, the problem two. So first of all, you have to decide whether it is SN1, SN2. Straight away, you can look for the solvent. It is DMF, dimethyl formamide, which is just like that. Dimethyl formamide is actually, this is H, this is C double bond O, this is N, and these are the two MEs. This is dimethyl formamide. So no polar hydrogen in this case. Don't confuse. This carbon hydrogen bond is there, but it is not a polar hydrogen as it is attached with the carbon. So it is again polar aprotic solvent, and polar aprotic solvent means you will always look for SN2 kind of the mechanism. Okay, so how you can do the SN2 mechanism for this one? Say this Na is positive and your SH is negative. Fine. So if you draw the complete picture of this one, so here you will have your, say, axial hydrogen. So this is given actually in this manner. However, this is not the stable configuration of this bromocyclohexane. It should be equatorial, but nonetheless, it is given there in the question itself that it is having in the axial position. Okay. And of course, one hydrogen and one hydrogen would be there. So what it can do, see, if this negatively charged nucleophile attacks from this position, so again these lone pairs would create difficulty. These lone pairs would create difficulty. So this attack would not occur actually, right? That means it will not occur from here. So from where the attack would occur, it will attack from the back of this halogen atom. See, again what would happen if it is attacking from here, so it will push this hydrogen equatorial carbon hydrogen bond of the cyclohexane to the axial position, and of course this will leave. Okay, so in the previous examples I haven't shown that process of leaving. So if it was attacking from here, so of course it will leave. And if it is attacking from that direction, it will leave. Similarly, if it is attacking from here, so it will also leave. So what product you will get here? It's quite simple again. Okay. So this was your carbon hydrogen equatorial bond, and your SH is actually approaching from that direction. So it will push that hydrogen to the axial position, which is up. Right, and this SH actually would occupy your equatorial position. Okay, so this actually forms bond in this way. But again, you can see here, this compound is actually not the optically active compound. It is not a chiral center there. That means no question of inversion of configuration, because it is not a chiral center actually. But of course, geometry would invert in that case also. So this is how you can see in case of the cyclohexane also. Now moving to the next kind of the problem, which is given here. So again, if we have given the substrate like that, attacking reagent and solvent like that, and substrate in this manner, you know this lithium is positively charged, which would be stabilized by the DMSO and setting this Br negative nucleophile free to attack on this one. But you can see halogen is there and halogen is also here. But if you see the nature of this one, right, so this is directly attacked with one carbon here and one carbon here and one carbon here. So it is what, tertiary kind of the substrate. Okay, and if you see this carbon, it is directly attached with only one, so this is primary substrate. And you know actually the primary substrates are more reactive towards SN2 kind of reaction. So this bromine, actually this bromine would attack on this carbon, which is having primary nature. Okay, it will never attack to this tertiary. Okay, because it is sterically quite hindered one, right? And then you will have your product, and of course your product would be like that. This chlorine is actually untouched, and you are having the Br here. Okay, so in this way you can solve the various problem based on the SN2 reactions. Now moving to the next problems. Okay, fine. Your next problem is like that. So I have to drag the problem in the frame. they are not on the frame actually, right? This was, say, the problem number 5. Arrange the following compounds in the increasing order of reactivity towards SN2 reaction. The question is there actually in the form of the SN2 reaction. Okay, so for SN2 reaction, you know, the primary substrate would be most reactive. So what you will do, you will first classify all the substrate into the primary, secondary and tertiary nature. So I'm using this pen here. So this is the carbon bearing halogen. It is attached with one carbon here and one carbon here. So this carbon is secondary in nature. And then you can see this is actually the carbon bearing halogen, and it is directly attached with one carbon here only. So it is the primary substrate. And for the same region, you can see this carbon is directly attached with one carbon only. It is also a primary substrate. Okay. And if you see this particular one, right, this carbon bearing halogen, it is directly attached with one carbon here, another carbon here and next carbon here. So it is a tertiary substrate. And in that case, you know, this is the vinyl halide. So as I told you, in case of the SN1 reactions also, these vinyl substrates are pretty bad. Whether you are going for SN1 reaction or SN2 reaction, they are actually the pretty bad one. So they are the worst. They are the worst substrate for SN2 as well as SN1 reaction. Okay. So they will not give actually the SN1 or SN2 reaction. Right. So what is the reason why they are the worst reagent? So I can explain here. Say just like that. Okay. Say this is bromine. This bromine is having what? Of course, your 3 lone pairs on it. So what would happen? This would come here and this would go there. So actually, the resonance is there. Okay. This kind of resonance. So this is what you can see, negative is here and you can see the positive is here. But you can see this entire species is having what? The partial double bond character. And due to this double bond character in the entire structure, the attack of the nucleophile is not very facile on this center. That's why it is very worst for the SN2 reaction. Moreover, you cannot create carbocation for this, stable carbocation with this vinyl halide. So it will not give the SN1 reaction also. I have explained this in my previous lecture also. You can go through my lectures. So this is the worst in the SN1 and SN2 reaction. Now you left with these one. Now you know primary substrates are the most reactive. So you can see this is the primary substrate, right? And this is also the primary substrate. So that means both can give very good your SN2 reaction. But you can see your I is better leaving group. I is better leaving group, right? When you move from top to bottom in the periodic table, just like that, if you have your fluorine and then you will have a chlorine, bromine and iodine. So when you move down the group, so leaving group ability increases. Okay, because see, this would have very large size when compared to the fluorine and others, so it can easily actually stabilize the negative charge on it. So if any species is stabilizing the negative charge very effectively, of course it will be a very good leaving group. So this I is the better leaving group than your BR. Okay, so that means it is actually the most reactive one. So what you can do, you can write this 3 here. I am writing 3 here. Okay, this is the most reactive one. And I told you already, this is the least reactive actually. Why? Because they are the worst for this reaction. So here you can write 5 here. Okay, now you left, see, these two have gone now. 3 and 5. Now you left with 2, 1 and 3. So again, it is primary. So it would be far more reactive than the other. So you can write this number 2 here. the number two species you can write here. Now there would be competition between secondary and tertiary. So secondary would be more reactive than tertiary. Then I have explained you this particular point. So you can find one here. Okay. And the fourth here. So five is the least reactive. Fourth is the second least reactive. And first is the reactive. And second is actually the second most reactive. And this is the most reactive in this reaction. So you can give the increasing order in this manner. Okay. So it doesn't matter whether you write in this way or you can write in this way. 3, then 2, okay, then 1, then 4, then 5. So this one and this one both are actually the correct answers. Okay. In this way you can decide actually. Now moving to the next one, next problem. The rate of the SN2 reaction will be negligible. So negligible kind, see this problem I have already explained to you in my previous lecture, but again I am going to explain. So straight away you can what you can see here, this is your 2 degree halide. I'm writing 2 degree for this one, okay, because this is directly attached with one carbon here, one carbon here, it is 2 degree, and it is your allyl. So allyl substrates are actually very good in SN2 reaction, so it will be more reactive than this one. And this is again your allyl. A conjugation is also there. This is also allyl bromide. It is also allyl bromide, but with extended conjugation. Extended conjugation. So this would be the second most reactive. And if you draw the diagram for this one actually, so this molecule is this actually. Okay, and your Br is here, and you know in the SN2 reaction your nucleophile must attack from the back. So in the back you see the bond is here and this bridge bond is there, this bond is here, so it is quite difficult to attack from the back, so SN2 reaction would not occur in that case. So this option C is the least reactive substrate among the all in the SN2 reaction. Okay, while this extended while this allyl bromide having extended conjugation would be the most reactive, so I am writing it as most reactive. Okay, this allyl bromide are more reactive than the secondary, so this is actually the third most, right? And then the order follows in this manner. Clear? I think up to this point there is no problem. Now moving to the next problem, which is actually say this one. Arrange the following in the decreasing order of reactivity towards SN2 reaction. So, okay, fine. This is again a very simplest one. Trick. I am giving you the trick. How you can decide. Right. So, again, what you will do, you will decide the nature of the carbon. Say, this is your carbon bearing halogen. And this carbon is what? 2 degree carbon. So you can write 2 degree for this one. See, sorry, not 2 degree. It is 3 degree carbon, because this carbon is directly attached with one carbon here and third one here. So it is tertiary in nature. Similarly, you can focus on this carbon. It is directly attached with one carbon here, one here, 2, 3 and 4. It is what? 4 degree. Okay. So if you add this, right? So this will give you what? 7, total sum of 7. If you want to add the nature of this also, so you can add 2 degree of this one also. So 7 plus 2, this will give you 9 actually. And if you move to this one, so this is what 2 degree, so you can write 2 for this one. So now the next carbon is what? This one. This is 1, 2 and 3. So you can put 3 degree here. Okay. And for this carbon, it is 2 degree, 1 here and 1 here. So 2, 3, 5, 7. So total sum is 7 here. In that case, the sum is 9. Then again, come here. In that case, this is secondary. This one is secondary. And this is directly attached with 1 only. So this is primary. And if you see this one, 1 here, 2. This is secondary. So 2, 2, 4 plus 1, 5. So it is giving 5 only. Now coming to this one, it is 2 degree. Okay. And it is directly attached with this one, 1, and one here, so 2 plus 2, this is secondary, and if you see this one, this is also secondary, because directly attached one here and directly attached carbon one here, 2 2 2 6. So you have made the addition of this one, 6, 5, 7 and 9. And the trick is that when you have the higher addition of these natures of the carbon, primary, secondary, tertiary and quaternary, then the species which is having the highest order would be the least reactive towards SN2 reaction. Least reactive towards SN2 reaction. Okay. But on the other hand, if the question was in the opposite manner, if the question was like that, arrange the following in the decreasing order of in towards SN1 reaction. So the species which is having the highest sum is least reactive in the SN2 reaction, but this would be most reactive. This would be most reactive towards SN1 reaction. So this is the trick actually. Okay. Now if you see the 7 is there. So again it is second most least reactive towards SN2. So in this manner you can arrange this one, and you have to arrange this in the decreasing order. Okay. So the lowest sum would be the most reactive one. So lowest sum is 5 here. So you can write number 2 here for this one, and then 6 you can write number 1, and then you can write number 3, and finally you can write your number 4. So this is the decreasing order of reactivity towards SN2 reaction for this species. Now moving to the next problem, you can see, so this actually is above the plane. You can see this is the solid wedge, this halogen is actually above the plane in this manner, and this hydrogen is below the plane, and this iodine actually must attack from the opposite face from that which is having the halogen atom. So it cannot attack from the top face, it must attack from the bottom face to avoid the steric repulsion given by the lone pairs of the halogen actually. Okay. So what happens here actually, you can see this would attack from that position. Okay. In that position, if it's attacking from that position, opposite face of this halogen, so it will push this hydrogen up actually. So you will have your product in this manner. This hydrogen has pushed up by this nucleophile, and your iodine would be downside. In this manner, you can see this one. Okay. Now moving to the next problem, see if time permits, I will again come back to this problem also, if time permits. Okay. Now my next problem is the problem number 10. Okay. What it says, which of the following species is most reactive towards the SN2 reaction? So what you can think the nature. First of all, you will see the nature actually of the alkyl halide. So this is the carbon. Okay. So this is directly attached with one carbon. Okay, no matter, it is primary substrate. This substrate is primary substrate. Similarly, this one is also 1 degree substrate, and this one is also 1 degree substrate. So this one is also 1 degree substrate. Fine. So all are 1 degree. So this is actually the problem which is based on the inductive effect also. Clear. So what would happen? You can see here, this is the methyl group, and methyl group would exert plus I effect. It will give the plus I effect. That means it will push the electron density towards itself, towards this benzene ring, and finally it will go through this bond, right? So what happens actually, the electron density increases here. So the bond of this actually becomes stronger. This bond actually becomes stronger. Okay. And you can think in this way, this is chlorine. This will exert the minus I effect. So it will suck the electron density towards itself, right? So making this carbon chlorine bond weaker. Similarly, this NO2, you know, it will show most effective minus I effect. It will show most effective minus I effect, right? And it will also show minus I effect, this species, this will show plus I effect, and in that case no effect. So arrange in the most, see which of the following is the most reactive. Of course this one would be the most reactive. So if the question is like that, you are having the same nature of the carbon which is bearing the halogen, right, then you can look for the inductive effect. Whenever the minus inductive effect is happening, that substrate would be the most reactive towards the SN2 reaction, and whenever the plus I effect is happening, that would be the least reactive. So this is actually the least reactive towards SN2 reaction, this one is the most reactive, and this one is the second most reactive, and this one is third most reactive. Okay, and the next question is what? Again, it is quite simple actually. So the role of crown ethers, actually I have already explained to you how these are very, very important. So what happens, see this F is negative, and see this positive is there. So this is the halogen, so this would attack from the top face, because it has to attack from the opposite face of this halogen. So you will have your product in this manner. Your fluorine is here. Okay, and of course this will leave, so you will have the Br negative. So these crown ethers, you must be knowing about these crown ethers. They are very, very important one. They actually traps this one, this potassium ion, right? So how very quickly, see, however I will try to make a video on the crown ethers, separate video on the crown ethers as the solvent, but right now you can think in this way. Say this is this oxygen I am giving here, another oxygen I am giving here, there's another oxygen I am giving here, say another oxygen, and then you can see this one, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So total of 5 I am giving. So you can number it actually. So our structure is not looking very pretty, but you can understand in this manner. So if you started numbering here, 1, 2, 3, okay, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, okay, 15, total 15s are there. So actually it is 15 crown ether, total atoms are 15 crown ethers. Okay, so these 15 crown ethers are effectively trap this positively charged cation, right, and setting this F negative free. Right, so it is not actually this crown ether is not disturbing your substrate, it is not disturbing your nucleophile, but it is actually trapping the K positive ion inside it. Okay, so that's why these crown ethers are actually pretty much useful in your this kind of SN2 reactions. Okay, crown ethers are very, very important. So this 15 crown ethers can trap your potassium ion. And if you have say little lower ion, like your lithium ion is there, if lithium is there, then you can use your 12 crown ethers. Okay, you can use 12 crown ethers. And if you use next other type of crown ethers, then you can count it here. Okay, in this way you can solve this kind of the problem actually. So I'll make a separate video if possible on the crown ethers. Now moving to the next problem, SN1 and SN2 products are, okay, you see, don't bother about stereochemistry, right, but you have to decide, say these substrates are given and you have to do SN1 reaction as well as SN2 reaction, and all the cases you, in which case you will find the same product. So I am giving you just one hint for this one. Say for example, I am starting SN2 for this one and my I negative is nucleophile. Okay, so what would happen actually? So say if it is above the plane, so my product would be like that. Okay, I negative. Okay, and for the same substrate, if I am doing SN1 reaction, okay, so first of all you will form in SN1 reaction a carbocation, this will leave, and when it leaves, it will give a positive here, it is 2 degree carbocation, but it will undergo hydride migration. Okay, this I have explained. Say this is hydrogen. So hydrogen migration, hydride ion migration was there, would be there, H negative migration. And then you will have this species, a secondary carbocation, which is more reactive than the primary in the SN1 reaction. And then you will have your, say, I negative. So it will attack from here. So you will have product just like that, methyl and iodide. So this product and this product are different. That means they will not give the same product when you do the SN1 and SN2 reaction. So in this way, you can try rest of all. However, I am quickly moving to the answer, which is the C, right here. So first of all, you do SN2. So in SN2, what would happen? This will gone, and whatever the nucleophile you will use, it will come here. Avoid your stereochemistry. Then you will have your, say, I here. This is SN2. Now if you do the SN1 for this one, so in SN1 reaction, first the carbocation would form, positive would be there. So if hydrogen migration would occur, there is no problem, because all the time it will remain secondary actually. So what would happen? Your I negative would attack on this one, okay, and you are having I negative. You can see in the SN2 you are having this product, in the SN1 you are having this product. In both the cases the products are same. That means the correct option is the option number C. You can try with the others also. Okay, now we can move further to some other problems. Okay, say these are the problems. Select in each pair that shows the greater SN2 reaction. So this is the pair, this is the pair, and this is the pair, this is the pair. Okay, fine. So nucleophile are same in the, in these cases you can see your nucleophiles are same. Okay, but you can see this Br is here and this OCH3 here. So this Br is the better leaving group. Br is better LG than your this kind of a species. Okay, so of course this pair would be far more reactive. Now comparing to this one, substrate are same, MEBR and MEBR, those are methyl bromide, same. And this is the nucleophile, and again the nucleophile is SH, but I told you in my previous lecture, right, negatively charged nucleophile are more effective than the neutral nucleophile. Okay, so this nucleophile is actually the neutral one, and this nucleophile is negative. So negative nucleophiles are more reactive, more effective in the reaction. So it is again this MEBR SH combination is better towards the SN2 reaction when compared to this one. Now moving to the next one, now you can see the substrate are same. Okay, substrate are same, and in these substrate you are having the different nucleophile, but in that case you can see you are using the DMSO. That means the reaction would follow SN2 reaction. Okay, and first the difference is what? The nucleophile. So you should remember this particular point. If you have, say, fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine, if you are using DMSO, or say polar aprotic solvent, if you are using a polar aprotic solvent, then your say nucleophilic nature increases in this way. Nucleophilicity increases nucleophilicity. So that means in DMSO this Cl is better nucleophile than your I. Fine. So that means this is again the better combination. So this I have explained in my previous lecture, where I have explained your C nucleophilicity and basicity. You can go through the lectures and see how we can decide. Now in the second case, see the substrates are same as I have written here actually, but you are using the protonated solvent. So in the protonated solvent actually, if you use say FClBri, okay, and you are using the protic solvent, not protonated, sorry, protic solvent. Okay, so this methanol is protic solvent, as it can give H positive. So in that case, when you move down the group, the nucleophilicity increases. NU nature increases. Now this time you can see your I is better nucleophile than your chlorine in the polar protic solvent. So of course this would be far more reactive. So in that manner you can assign this one. Now my next question is what? This OH negative, which is the nucleophile, and you are using again a polar aprotic solvent. DMF is what? Polar aprotic kind of the solvent. So this OH negative would attack on this one. So this is the halogen. Okay, this is the halogen. So it cannot attack from that phase. It is not possible due to the repulsion. So it will attack from this phase and it will push the hydrogen up. So what product you will get here? What product you will get here? So you will not disturb your Me and H, but this hydrogen would be pushed up by this OH negative, so hydrogen would gone up and your say OH would be downside. Of course the configuration would also change. Now my last problem, see the length of the video is actually increased pretty much, so I am restricting this lecture up to this problem only. And the problem is like that: which of the following species is actually having the faster reaction rate? So faster reaction rate they are asking in the question, but it is not given whether it is SN1 or SN2. So I am giving both SN1 as well as the SN2. So first of all, you should know this is tertiary butyl group. This is your tertiary butyl group. This is the locking reagent, locking group actually. This will lock the chair conformation in this fashion so that the flipping of the chair would not occur. And you see this is going up and this is going down. So this is the transisomer. Okay, this is upside, this is downside. And in this one again you see this is up one and this iodine is up. So this is the cisisomer. Okay, so how you can go this one? Now it's very easy to explain. Say this is say you are going for SN1. Say you are going for the SN1 and also you are going for the SN1 reaction. Okay, so in the SN1 reaction your carbocation would form. So how you can explain your carbocation? You can see generally what happens. You see in that case this is say 1 2 3 1 3 diaxial repulsion. This is 1 2 3 again 1 3 diaxial repulsion. So due to this 1 3 diaxial repulsion, this I27, which has to be replaced by the I128 actually, right? So there is actually what steric repulsion. It is not in a better position. So what it will do actually, it will very readily form carbocation, very readily form carbocation. Okay, so you can consider this case as steric acceleration. You can consider this case as steric acceleration. I am repeating, this I negative due to the 2 1 3 diaxial interaction, this I127 is not very comfortable in this position. So it actually really it is wanting actually to release this repulsion. So it quickly removes from here actually, and it will give you the carbocation. Okay, in this manner it will produce a carbocation. While in that case you can see this is actually the equatorial position, and there is no such 1,3 diaxial kind of interaction. So it is actually a little bit more comfortable than this one in this stage. So it will not very readily form the carbocation. So if you consider the SN1 reaction, so your cis isomer is the most reactive. It will give the fast reaction rate in the SN1 reaction. Okay, now if you consider the SN2 reaction, okay, so now I am considering the SN2. For example, you are having your I128, this kind of species, and say if it bonds attack from this end, So I will give the repulsion actually, na? This will give the repulsion. So the attack from this phase is not fissile. It has to attack from here actually, from that position. While in that case, you can see if you have I-28, then very easily what you can see it is going. So it can attack from that position. But the moment it will attack from this position, it will again feel the repulsion from these three hydrogens, say, right? So in that case, you can see in the SN2 reaction, this is actually feeling repulsion from this one, which is quite bigger iodine, but these are not so bigger, hydrogens are not so big one, right? So this trans actually is the most reactive in SN2 kind of reaction. So this is very very important actually. In case of the trans isomer, this would be the faster reaction rate, and in case of the cis, this is not very fast. And the reason is that here was steric acceleration, but here you can see these hydrogens are quite small actually, so it can attack readily from this position. However, attack from here it is not possible. However, if it is attacking from this position in the cis isomer, so this iodine is actually quite bigger. It will not allow to attack from this position. So in SN1 reaction, the condition is different. In SN2 reaction, the condition is different. So these are the some of the problems based on the SN1 reaction and SN2 reaction. And see, if you know this much of SN1 and SN2 reaction and the concept used to solve the different kinds of the problem, then you will never face any difficulty in solving the problem, whether they are the problem of your boards and you are the problem, they are the problem of your IIT JAM, NEET or CSIR NET, whatever, wherever you will go, these concepts will always apply. Guys, so this is that's it for this particular lecture. So guys, please share this video and the Tetrahedron Chemistry Classes channel with your friends, right? Because if you share, see, sharing is caring actually. If you share the content, if you share the knowledge, then your knowledge would increase. So kindly share this Tetrahedron Chemistry Classes with your friends, and also subscribe the channel, and don't forget to press the bell icon for the latest notification. Thank you. Thank you very much.